Hello and welcome to Some Assembly Required. In this video, we're finally moving away from implementing the CPU. That part is done, sort of, and moving to the next stage, which is implementing an Apple II. We'll start with an Apple II Plus. The Some Assembly Required GitHub page now has a new repository called Apple II Plus. Right off the bat, I ran into a bit of a problem. Good FPGA design requires that you do not convert the clock yourself, but use PLL, or in this case MMCM design, in order to change the clock's frequency. The board supplies us with a 50 MHz clock and we need 1 MHz for the CPU. However, when we feed 50 MHz into the design, we find that we cannot ask for a 1 MHz clock. It's just too slow. With that being the case, I had no choice but to design the clock divider myself. To avoid noise on the clock, I used always FF blocks or flip-flop blocks. I'm hoping that with this design I will not have the artifacts that are the reason why you're not supposed to do this. I did attempt to make sure that I'm not completely off. I'm not sure how authoritative this test is. In any case, there do not appear to be irregularities. So we have CPU and we have a clock. It's time to start taking care of the memory map. The Apple II Plus has 64 kilobytes of RAM, 12 kilobytes of ROM, and 4 kilobytes dedicated for memory mapped I/O, called soft switches on the Apple. Of course, the CPU can only address 64 kilobytes of memory, so some of those have to overlap. To make things simpler for this stage of the project, no overlap was done. So 48 kilobytes of RAM, 4 kilobytes of memory mapped I/O, and 12 kilobytes of ROM. Of course, at this point, we're not doing the memory mapped I/O either. So just 48 kilobytes of RAM and 12 kilobytes of ROM. First, there are the ROM files. I have the Apple II Plus ROM files in 2 kilobyte segments, but those are not loadable by Vivado. In order to make them loadable by Vivado, we need to convert them into MEM files. Next, I need to define a ROM unit. Not much to it. I get a string parameter to tell me which mem file to load, and then it's just initializing the memory from the file and giving a read-only bus access. It is difficult for me to stress just how wasteful this approach is. However, at this point in time, it doesn't matter. With that out of the way, it was time to introduce the RAM. I used both single port and dual port modules, both generated from Xilinx IP catalog. You asked for 8-bit wide memory over 2 kilobytes. Define a second port so that you can access the memory from two areas at the same time. And you're done. I had to deal with strange problems where the CPU wouldn't read from the reset vector for reasons I've never found out why. Which is really strange because the interrupt vector did work. I spent a lot of time on this problem, even going as far as hooking up a logic analyzer so that I could make sure that the real results are the same as the simulation results. And they were. The CPU really wasn't reading the reset vector. In the end, I made a change that I can only describe as random, till finally we were reading from the reset vector. FFFC returns 6-2. FFFD returns FA, and we indeed continue execution at FA62. Which isn't to say that our problems were over. We soon perform a jump subroutine, in which case we write FA to 1F8 and 65 to 1F7. However, when it comes time to read these addresses back, 1F7 reads back FF, and 1F8 reads back 00. So we read the wrong address back, and our return from subroutine indeed jumped somewhere random. And from there, obviously, things don't go very well. It took a long time to try and figure this out. I even went on Reddit, where I got back this answer. I just spent the past 2 days messing with the new memory generator for that too. It would not correctly generate my 4 kilobytes of BRAM. That's block RAM. I had to infer it in HDL to get it to work. So not very encouraging. With that in mind, I had to go in a different direction. Essentially, I did with the RAM what I previously done with the ROM. I implemented it manually. Of course, then it turned out that I don't have enough blocks to implement the entire RAM. I ended up implementing about 16 kilobytes of RAM. Far cry from the 48 I was aiming for. However, with these sacrifices, something great came about. So as before, we have a jump subroutine to FE84, and we write to 1F8 we write FA, and to 1F7 we write 65, as before. However, this time when it comes to the return, we read from 1F7 the value 65 we wrote before, and from 1F8 we read the value FA we wrote before, and we continue execution at FA65 where we left off. Amazing! The obvious happened. This means the boot procedure can now continue. So I started simulating longer and longer increments. That's a whole millisecond each time. But then I saw something troubling. I kept reading from the more or less the same area. FCAC, FCAD. Another millisecond passes by, and then another and another, and we're still in the same area. Notice that we're 34 milliseconds after the boot started, and we seem to be stuck in the loop. Now, ideally I'd say, well, obviously at some point the boot finishes. However, I expected to see a write to the 400 addresses where the text segment is stored, and that did not happen. So that got me worried that I'm not working correctly. To try and combat that, I went to the original. Well, almost original. So yes, this is an emulator and not the actual hardware. However, AppleWin has very high fidelity, even when running on Linux. If we go to the Apple monitor, we can ask to disassemble areas of the memory. So we're stuck in FCAA. We see FCA9. FCA9 is 48, FCAA is E9. So obviously our computer is executing the same code as AppleWin, which is good. So push A, subtract 1, branch not equal to FCAA. This is a loop subtracting 1 from the accumulator until it's 0. When that's done, it pulls A from the stack, subtract 1s, and branch not equal to FCA9, which again pushes the accumulator to the stack and does this loop all over again. So what this loop does is, so let's say A is 100, pushes 100, counts down from 100 to 0, pulls 100, subtract it to 1, so 99, and does it again from 99 to 0, pulls it, subtract 1 to 98, counts down from 98 to 0. That's a delay loop. Why on earth would we have a delay loop in the Apple boot sequence? In order to understand why this delay loop is here, we want to find the code that called it. The code that called the subroutine had to write the return address on the stack. So we will search the timeline for two consecutive writes that the return address type. Since the loop itself only does a single write to store the accumulator, two consecutive writes should stick out quite easily, even when zoomed out. Here we go. We came from FBE7. And here's our answer. So this starts at FBE4. So we see we load 12, we jump to our delay subroutine, and then we load A from CO30, we decrement Y. To know how much Y is, we'll probably need to start disassembling earlier. So FBE0. So Y gets loaded with C0, A gets loaded with 12, we do delay, we load A from C030, we decrement Y, and if Y isn't 0, we jump to E4, load A with C again, and repeat. Now this seems to make no sense, and it wouldn't make any sense unless you know what C030 is. Remember the memory map I referenced earlier? C000 is the memory mapped I/O. C030 is a soft switch. In particular, C030 does a tick on the speaker. What we're experiencing here is the startup beep. So now we know what it is, but we want to see that we got past it, right? So let's start increasing these numbers as well. 100 milliseconds. So we definitely seem to be doing something else. 134 milliseconds into the boot and we're not beeping anymore. Good, I guess. Let's give it 50 milliseconds more. This is the key, quite literally. C000 is a soft switch that tells the system whether a key is pressed, and if so, which. FD21, we see, is a bit from C000, and then it does branch plus to FD1B. This means that if a key is not pressed, i.e. the bit 7 is clear, we count how much idle time we have at 4E and 4F, but essentially we're waiting for a key press. So at 180 milliseconds, our boot is more or less done. And here is what we've been waiting for. 400, write A0. A0 is a black space, so this is just clear the first address. Clear the second address. Clear the third address and so on. So 116 milliseconds into the boot process, we're clearing the screen. So we're finally booting, probably. Not exactly a very satisfying conclusion. We'd rather be able to see with our own eyes the basic prompt, but we'll leave that for the next video. Until then, thank you for watching.